In the 1930s, a remote farmhouse in Cashin's Gap on the Isle of Man became the focus of weird events. Following a poltergeist outbreak, a small strange creature appeared. The Irving family, who owned the house, heard the animal speak. It claimed to be a mongoose called Gef, who had been born in India in 1852. Gef haunted the family for almost a decade and became world famous. He was even mentioned in the British Parliament. Although the house at Cashin's Gap was demolished in 1971, Gef remains a Fortean icon to this day.
Hello again, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. It's me, Barry Tadcaster, back again. And this is my old mate, Gef the Talking Mongoose. I'm an earth wonder at world, me. Thou shalt never know what I am. I already know what you are, you're a talking mongoose. Well, that's by the by. I was born in New Delhi in 1852. Hey, well, you've aged quite well, ain't you, mate? Oh yes, oh yes. It's Friday, it's 5 to 5, it's time for Cracker Jack. What are you talking about? Oh no, it's not Cracker Jack, is it? It's on the Track Xtra.
Unless you've been living under a rock in the back of a very lonely cave for the last few months, you will know that the human race, the entire human race, is living through some very strange times at the moment. They're undeniably interesting times, but they're strange, and they're very, very, very frightening. On the Track will continue broadcasting, if that's the word, for something that goes out on YouTube for as long as we are able to do it, for as long as we have the technology, the internet access, and our health. But because these are non-standard times, this is another non-standard episode. But we hope you enjoy it. And now up to Scotland for the final part of my conversation with Leanne, a Scottish occultist, about strange things happening in the Loch Ness vicinity, particularly around Boleskine House, which for many years was the home of the notorious occultist Aleister Crowley. Enjoy.
Do people still carry out rituals in the graveyard? Because I know in the 60s, one of the Loch Ness Monster investigators, and I can't for the life of me remember who, found a strange scroll with writing he couldn't decipher, and a big conch shell that had been made into a trumpet, found those somewhere in the graveyard. I wonder if people still do rituals there now.
I think people do. Because there's this rumour of the tunnel that Crowley had it. Well, when it was the monks, in fact, they had it first, and it was rumoured that Crowley was using this tunnel. And the entrance to this tunnel is just disputed, and I think people do go, well, I don't know about now, but certainly, yes, in the past few years, yeah, I think people have been up to stuff up there in the middle of the night, performing things. I do know of what I know, when was, I can't think when that was, the people that owned it before all this happened, it meant like years ago, they reported people in the graveyard at one point, like 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning, I remember that in the paper, but nothing was ever really done about it. I don't know what was happening there.
Golly.
So,
do you think there's any link between Crowley and the Loch Ness Monster?
That's been mentioned, hasn't it? And, well, I mean, the sightings go back away before he was even born.
Yeah.
But it can't be, you can't just gloss over the fact that we've got this strange creature and Crowley, you know what I mean? There's got to be, I don't know, I think he was certainly fascinated by it. That's like little known facts about him, and I don't know if there's a link as such, or did he, like, I know that a lot of people speculate that with the magic, you know, and that's how it's not actually flesh and blood, it's a paranormal creature, and that's correlating between Crowley and, you know, I don't know. It's fascinating. As I say, the sightings will go way beyond him, so I don't know how there could be a really, it's quite tenuous, if you know what I mean.
I know exactly what you mean. I was just wondering whether the people who are Crowley followers in your area had any theories on this.
Well, I don't. It doesn't really come up much when I'm trying to think.
To be quite honest, I'd much rather you said that than told me that there was a whole coven of people trying to raise the Loch Ness Monster.
Oh, no, there's nothing like that. The only thing I know about that sort of thing, there was a white witch, I think he was from England, and he was up in, this was years ago, he was up and down the boat, and he was banging
Kevin
a drum.
Carlyle.
Pardon?
Kevin Carlyle.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, he was trying to do something, wasn't he, to raise the monster. This whole area is just strange. I mean, there's even, I don't know, I'm sorry to go off on a tangent here, but did you know about the legends of werewolves around here?
Werewolves?
Yeah.
No. I knew of some Scottish legends, but I didn't know about that. Please tell me more.
Well, I mean, I've only heard from people out in the wild. I mean, we're talking like, so this is Fort Augustus, so then on the road you've got Fort William, all the wilderness around there, around this area. There's people been reporting of werewolves and sightings of wolf, strange wolf-like creatures walking on two legs, going back, well, from hundreds of years. And it's really weird because my neighbour, she's dead now. She died a couple of weeks ago. She was, when I moved in here, she was telling me a few things about the area because I was asking her about, you know, if she's seen anything, and especially in the Loch or whatever. But she said she hasn't seen anything in the Loch. But what she did see was one night she said that she was woken by a crash, and our fences are about, I don't know, 6 foot high out the back, and she looked out her window. She couldn't see anything, and then all of a sudden she saw this huge big black thing jump straight over the fence, and she said she got the fright of her life. She had to phone her daughter to come up from the Abbey, and the daughter actually took her from the house to the Abbey to stay that night. She couldn't stay in the house, she was that scared. So there's so many things going on up here, and I can actually really understand why people link Crowley to these things as well, because, well, it's easy to sort of make a connection, isn't it?
Yeah, so David Attenborough came into the butterfly farm where I used to work back in about 2010, and I mentioned the Yeti to him, and he basically said to me that he can't see why those footprints would have been faked at that time, at that altitude, and he was quite open to the idea that there was some sort of large unknown animal in the region, and I was just wondering what you thought of that.
Well, the thing about the Shipton photographs was they're in snow, so an animal can leave its prints in the snow, then they can thaw and it distort the outline, and then they'll freeze again, making them look bigger than they actually are. So footprints in snow, unless they're very, very recent, are not good evidence. But I've seen tracks in mud in northern India, man-like tracks that sunk very deeply into the mud. And I think he's right, there is a large unknown animal in the Himalayan region and other parts of Asia. And I think it's either a great ape or a relic hominid.
Mm-hmm. Well, the footprints certainly don't match up with the bear. If they were, the feet would be the wrong way around, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
Tell us a bit, Richard, about your expedition to northern India and the Mande Burung.
Yes, back in 2010, I went to northern India with the CSF expedition to search for the Yeti there. The local name for it is Mande, Barung, which means forest man. and it was in the Garrow Hills, which are in Meghalaya, which is in the northeast of the country, just underneath Assam. In fact, it used to be part of Assam at one time. But there are stories that go up through Meghalaya, through Assam, and into Bhutan. It's Mande Burung in Meghalaya, Konglin Po in Assam, and Maigo up in Bhutan are the names for it. But I talked to a number of witnesses, mainly from the hill tribes, who had seen this creature. One man saw it from a hill. He was looking down at it. He hadn't seen him, and he said the thing was as tall as an elephant, about 10 feet.
Wow.
Black hair, the typical sagittal crest, like a gorilla, very bulky, and he was making a nest, like a gorilla makes a nest. He was making this huge nest, and he sat and watched it for hours. Another guy in the same area said he had seen one in a stand of bamboo, and he thought these stories were nonsense until he saw one, and he said it was a female suckling a young, and you could see the baby's legs. She was sitting down, and even in sitting down position she was 5 feet tall. And she was eating bamboo whilst the baby suckled. Another guy said he'd seen it years ago, back in the 60s, and he was out searching for herbs in the jungle. He said he saw this huge creature, about 10 feet tall, and he said it was shaking the vegetation. You know how a gorilla shakes the vegetation as a threat, and making this deafening roar, and he was terrified and ran away. And another guy, whose father was a well-renowned hunter. His father is long since dead, and the guy we talked to is a conservationist, but his dad was a hunter. He said he'd hunted all of the animals in that area. He said he saw this thing in a clearing, and it was squatted down. It looked like a huge gorilla. It was squatted down, and it was sort of searching through the undergrowth as if it was looking for things to eat in the undergrowth. And all of them are adamant that it is not a bear that they've seen.
Well, the size of an elephant would be very, very big. I'm assuming there's exaggeration there.
Well, about 3 metres. It's the height of an Indian elephant. It means in height, not in bulk.
Yes, but even that would be very, very big.
Mm.
And then there's this.
If you want to support us and help us make more content like these, please press like, subscribe, follow our Facebook page, and check out our Patreon.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's about it for this episode, and I'd like to say a big thank you to everyone who helped me put it together. Before anybody gets righteously indignant and starts to dob us into the forces of law and order, all the shots that had more than one person in were taken many months ago. And I've been holding them in the archive until now. There will be more episodes during the lockdown, and I hope to have another episode out in a week or so. I would like to reassure you that, as far as I'm aware, everybody on the CFZ team is doing okay at the moment. I spoke to Charlotte and her mum and dad yesterday. They're coping fine. Me, Karina and Graham are fine. And I spoke to Richard a couple of days ago and Carl the day before that, and they seem to be doing okay as well. Even Wally's doing okay, except he is self-isolating over in a forest in Parkham somewhere, which is where all the rhinoceroses in the area come from. Karina had another minor operation last week and will be going in for another one as soon as they can fit her in around the virus emergency. And basically, life carries on as normal. There will be another episode soon, and so until then, be seeing you.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's me again. Over the last few months, you've probably noticed that On the Track has changed. Well, there's a very good reason for that. The thing is that between 2000 and 2017, that's 17 years for those of you who can't count, I was the main promoter of an annual event called The Weird Weekend. And it was a conference aimed at, about, and for people from the Centre for Fortean Zoology. And although it wasn't all about cryptozoology, it was all full of events and lectures and film shows and exhibitions on subjects which I thought that people from the Centre for Fortune Zoology would be interested in. And it was all wrapped up in a nice overcoat of surreal fun. And you know what? I miss it terribly, which is why about 6 months ago I decided that I was going to rebrand on the track. I thought we'd do a monthly episode of about half an hour, and then in between each episode we do what I call On the Track Xtra, which resurrects somewhat of the feel of the old Weird Weekend. And have a look at these two examples, which I chose almost at random because I thought that you might enjoy them.